Great thing. Psalm 34, 1 through 10. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing.
Psalm 81, 13 through 16. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. I would soon subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe toward him, and their fate would last forever. But he would feed you with the finest of the wheat, and with honey from the rock I would satisfy you.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Well, everything I need you got, there's honey in the rock. Praying for a miracle, thirsty for the living well, but only you can satisfy. Sweetness at the mercy seat, now I taste it, it's not hard to see, but only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock. 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 Freedom where the Spirit is. Bounty in the wilderness. You will always satisfy. There's honey in the rock. Water in the stone.
Provide. I have all that I need. You are.
trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus.
Amen. If you believe that, praise Him.
Acknowledge their need a Savior. They are a sinner in need of a Savior. Recognize that you are that Savior. They would turn and trust in you and follow you. Make you Lord of their lives. We just praise you for all that you do. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
May we see.
I'm always kind of torn at this point. I'm anxious to get going. But I don't want the music to stop either, so it's kind of that thing, you just kind of have to weigh that all out. Let's just start with some prayer. Holy Spirit, we just ask that you would come and invade this place. That you would take this message and reveal the truth to us. So let it be. Amen. And amen. Your kingdom come. A phrase that we're probably all familiar with. A phrase that we all may not quite understand what that means. Your kingdom come. One of the things I read this week said, the hardest petition in the Lord's Prayer, because we don't fully understand it or its implications. We are also more concerned about ourselves and our own little kingdoms, and more concerned about our own names and reputations rather than God's name and His reputation. So what is this kingdom? What's it look like? What's it supposed to be? Well, the next line in this prayer tells us, your will be done. That's what that kingdom looks like. Your will be done. One of the things I read said, that space where God's will is impeccably obeyed. Unquestionably obeyed. That's the kingdom of God. And our prayer says, we want that prayer to come where? Where do we want that prayer? Where do we want His kingdom to come to? On earth. Thank you. I know y'all know that. You were just afraid to say it. Well, that's just too simple. We all know the answer to that one. If it's not Jesus, it must be... We always... Well, never mind. I'm gonna... On earth as it is in heaven. And I used to always think, well, that was a God thing. God had to send that down to us. But when I start to understand it's the obeying of His will, then that means, wait a minute, I have a role in that. I have a role in bringing that kingdom down because it depends on my obedience. It's not solely a God thing. I've got to take on that responsibility. Romans chapter 15 says, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating or drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and receives human approval. We have a role. We have a role in this. As you notice, I'm not good at slides. I'm not that organized. I've never been to seminary, so I've never learned how to do a message. So I just kind of wing it a little bit. So you're going to have to depend on your own Bible or your own app or whatever it is you use. There are Bibles in the chairs, too, if you're interested in following along. I'll try to keep you up on where I'm at on this thing. We're going to continue through Acts 16. And we're going to look at this whole idea of the kingdom. Like having a kingdom perspective on how you approach things. And we're going to do that by looking through Acts 16. Pastor Chris, a couple weeks ago, introduced us to this chapter, and he talked about how Paul and Silas, they wanted to go to Asia to take the gospel there, and the Holy Spirit said, no, I don't want you to go there, which really is kind of our first indication of a kingdom perspective. It's not what I want to do. It's what God wants me to do. Taking the gospel to Asia, certainly a good thing. We would all say, wow, that's a very good thing to do. And they could have said, this is a good thing to do. Let's just go do this. But God said, no. I don't want you to do that. I may send you later. I may send someone else. But right now, I don't want you to do that. I've been a part of this body for over 40 years. And during that time, I've come across people who have said, you know, I was invited to come to this church, my initial reaction is, I don't think so. I don't believe that's the place for me. For whatever reason, a variety of reasons. But they finally submit to what the Spirit wants them to do, and when they get there, they go, okay, I see. God wants me to be a part of this body. It's the same thing. It's that kingdom perspective. It's not what I want. It's what God wants. His will be done. So as we continue through this, they go to Macedonia like Paul had the vision to go to. They go to Philippi, which is a colony there in Macedonia. It's a village there. And it says, on the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate to the river where we expected to find a place of prayer. The Jewish law said if 10 Jewish men got together, they had to establish a synagogue. Well, there either weren't 10 men in Jewish men in Philippi, or there weren't 10 committed men in Philippi. For whatever reason, it wasn't a synagogue, so they met together for prayer, and they went and found them. There's the interesting part. So they went there. We sat down and began to speak with the women who had gathered there. So ain't no minimum men being there. They met with the women who had gathered there. I got to tell you, it reminds me of Tuesday morning prayer service. It's me and the ladies. I'm just saying. It's me and the ladies. Thank God for ladies.
Amen.
Thank God for godly ladies.
Amen.
Y'all may not know it, but they're the prayer warriors of this body.
Amen.
Y'all may not realize it, but they're interceding on your behalf every Tuesday morning. When the invitation is given to come down and pray before the service, the majority of them are women. Men, I'm not saying anything about you. I'm just throwing out seed, and whatever God does with it, He does with it. That's all I'm saying. Okay? I'm not up here to judge anybody about that. Okay? So they worship together with these ladies, and among them there's a woman named Lydia. Lydia is a Gentile who was attracted to the Jewish religion and was joining these ladies. She was apparently a wealthy woman. And man, she is described as the way we all should want to be described. She was a worshiper of God. That's how Scripture describes her. She was a worshiper of God. Ooh, man, there's a good description to have. And because of that, the Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. When you come here on Sunday and you gather together, if you want to receive a message from God, she just told us how. A kingdom perspective of, I'm going to come and worship God. And when I do that, He's going to open my heart. I'll receive the message that He has for me. It may be through a song. It may be through a scripture. It may be through the message. I don't know how He wants to deliver it. I know He's got one for you. And He's got one for you every Sunday. And it'll be different for each of us. But it starts with, I got to be a person of worship. Then He will open my heart to receive the message He has for me. Whew. This is pretty good stuff, y'all. So she accepts that message. She becomes a Christian. She responds to the message that Paul has for her. She invites him to come stay. As a matter of fact, she says, Hey, if I'm a Christian, if you consider me a believer in the Lord, come and stay at my house. Give me some affirmation. Give me some affirmation. Come stay with me. And that's what they do. And this is how they kick off their time in Macedonia. This is how they kick off their time in Philippi. And God's like, ooh, there's some good stuff. There's some good stuff there. What are the kingdom perspectives there? They went to church. They gathered together to pray. Lydia was a worshiper. There's another kingdom perspective. I got to have that attitude of worship. And by the way, it's just not on Sunday. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. That's an everyday attitude. It's an everyday thing. And then I have to receive the message that He has for me. I've got to be willing to receive that message. Another kingdom perspective. So as we go on, verse 16 says, and once Paul and Silas, they were going to the place of prayer again. and they were met by a slave girl. And she earned a great deal of money for her owners by telling the future. She started following him around and said, "These men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved." Now, we just hear that, and it's printed in a word. We don't know how she was saying that. Was she being sarcastic? Was she putting them down? We don't really know. Scripture doesn't tell us what was going on there when we first read that. But she was telling the truth. But we also know that she had a demon in her because she could tell the future. And because of that, she was being abused by these guys to make money. And she kept this up for many days. And my translation says, "Finally, Paul became so annoyed that he turned around and said to the spirit, 'In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her.' And at that moment, the spirit left her." I shared with Dale this week, I didn't understand why Paul waited so long. Why didn't he just do it the first time he saw her? Well, maybe he didn't have that discernment. Maybe he didn't understand what her motive was at that point. One of the things I read this week said, Satan may have been trying to get into this small group. I'm going to tear this group up from the inside out. I'm going to get inside them and I'm going to have some false teaching from inside that group. We don't know. But we do know that somewhere along the line, Paul said, "I've had enough of this. I'm putting an end to this stuff." And he does. He has a discernment. I believe that's another kingdom perspective. To have a discernment to understand what's really going on. And then to remove that demon from her. And we would read that and say, boy, that must be a good thing. I imagine the community applauded what happened to this little girl. That's what we saw what happened. Jesus did. The people would be in awe. They'd be amazed. And you would think, yay. Maybe not so much. When her owners realized that their hope of making money was gone, oops, we tapped into somebody's money source. That never goes well. They seized Paul and Silas, dragged them into the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, "These men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice." And the people joined in to attack them. Took Paul and Silas to the magistrates. Now, we'll hold off on that for a second. What you have to understand, and Jesus warned us about this, when you start to have this kingdom perspective, when you start to live in a life of obedience to God, not everybody's going to love it. Not everybody's going to accept it. You're going to face persecution along the way. We hear this in the news. Most of you know are aware of the woman in England who got arrested for praying across the street from an abortion clinic. Praying silently across the street, the police came up to her and specifically asked, "Are you praying?" I would have said, "No, I'm just chatting with God." See what they said. But they specifically asked, "Are you praying? You're under arrest. You had to come with us." It's not unlike this, by the way. That interferes with some money making. There's a lot of money being made on the altar to sacrifice in unborn children. And when things start to happen, and we see it, we hear the laws being passed, you can only get within so many yards and blah, 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 blah. We see it. It's the same thing. And if you violate that, you'll be persecuted. On a much lesser scale, there was a guy in the Mall of America that had a t-shirt on that said, "Jesus is Lord" on the front. On the back it had, "Coexist," the circle, line through it, "Jesus is the only way." The mall blocks of the store, the mall cops, came up and said, "You got to take that shirt off or leave the mall." He was just wearing a shirt. And that's what happened. And that's in America. So you got to be ready. If you're going to be bold, if you're going to have this kingdom perspective, there may be some opposition along the way. But you got to fight through it. Well, let's continue the story. Let's see what happens here. So the crowd joined the end, attacked Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were then thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell, fastened their feet to the stocks. I gotta be honest. If this were me, about this time, if I was talking to God at all, to be honest, if I hadn't already just cut that off, but if I was talking to God, I'd be saying, God, I came right where you wanted me to come. I'm doing exactly what you wanted me to do. I planted a seed for the first church in Philippi. I kicked the demon out of this little girl, and my blessing for my obedience is I've been severely beaten, thrown in jail, fastened to the floor. Hello? But that's not a kingdom perspective. That's a me perspective. That's a me perspective. God, this isn't working out right. And if I were a true believer of the open door theology, I would say this door's being slammed shut. I took a wrong turn somewhere along the way. A real wrong turn along the way. Well, nope, again, that's not a kingdom perspective of things. That's getting ready to get good, folks. I'm just warning you. It's going to get really good. If you're asleep, wake up, because the good part's about to happen. All right? Hang on. We're going to see what happens when you have a kingdom perspective when all hell breaks loose. When things look bad, but you keep a kingdom perspective. Ooh, let's see what happens. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. They were praying and singing hymns to God. Overflow. They were praying and singing hymns to God. And I don't think these were, oh, woe is me prayers. I don't think these are, this is all about me prayers. God, get me out of this. I believe these were kingdom perspective prayers that said, God, how are you going to be glorified in what I'm going through? God, how can I glorify you in the midst of all this chaos? It's not about me. It's about him. I read this morning where God, he's not concerned about your happiness. He's concerned about your holiness. That's what God wants to build on. And sometimes you have to go through the mud to get there. But it ain't about you, y'all. It ain't about you. It's about him. His will be done. So about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening to them. People watch, y'all. People are watching how you respond to things. They see it when you respond differently. They see it when it's not about you, but it's about him. They notice. Yeah. Right. They notice. People see it because it's different. It's weird. It's odd. Yeah. But they see it. And suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Yeah. Did y'all hear that?
Yeah.
When you pray, oh, just imagine, if we all came in here and we were all focused in our prayer, we were focused in our worship, God wants to take the church and shake us up.
Yeah.
He wants to shake us up. He wants your chains to fall off. Yeah. He wants you to be free when you leave this place. Yeah. That's what God wants to do. He wants, wouldn't that be great? Can you imagine what's going on in here? This is just great stuff. I just love this stuff. By the way, that's the kingdom perspective. This prayer and worship in the midst of this chaos. And ooh, did God have a message? And the jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword, and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Hey, don't harm yourself. We are all still here." Everybody's prison door opened up, not just Paul and Silas. Everybody's chains fell off, not just Paul and Silas. I was a parole officer at the prison for over 26 years. If everybody would still be in that place when that happened, that's a miracle, y'all. That's a miracle. These guys were still there. Why were they still there? Because something better was going on inside that jail than what they would find outside that jail. There was freedom in that jail that they weren't finding outside of that jail. They weren't leaving. There was something good going on. I want to see what it is. I want to be a part of this thing. I'm sticking around. Folks, that's what we want. We want people to come here and say, hey, I don't know what's going on in there exactly, but I know whatever it is, it's better than what I'm going to find outside of this place. I want to be a part of that. But you got to bring them here, y'all. You got to have them in here to see it. You got to take it out to them. They got to see that there's something different about you, and you can get a chance to tell them, I'll tell you about it. I'll tell you who he is. Come join us. And they'll say, man, I want to be a part of that. I want that freedom that he has. I don't know what kind of change you have this morning. I don't know what's got you bound down, messed up, screwed up, distracted. I don't know what it is. But I know he's got an answer for you. I know he's got freedom for you. And we're going back to that kingdom perspective, prayer and worship. It all started with prayer and worship. And I imagine if Paul and Silas were going, oh, okay. I see why we were beaten. I see why we were thrown in jail. We had to bring God into this place. God had something really cool going on. But we had to get in here and bring it into this place. So the jailer hears, wait, everybody's still there? And he called for the lights. He rushed in. He fell trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and asked, hey, y'all. That's my version. Hey, y'all. What must I do to be saved? Did you hear that? Hey, y'all. What must I do to be saved? Have you ever heard those words? Has anybody ever come up to you and said, hey, what must I do to be saved? Should be pretty commonplace. I confess I haven't heard them a lot. That's the reaction. When you start having that kingdom perspective of things, you start being obedient to what God wants, that's the reaction. People want to know, hey, what must I do to be saved? And they replied, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all their household were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house, set a meal before them. He was filled with joy. Kind of takes us back to that Roman thing, I believe. For the kingdom of God is a matter of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Funny how it all works together. Because anyone who serves in this way is pleasing to God and receives human approval that we just saw. Please God. There was human approval. Scripture doesn't tell us this, but I'm going to go out on the limb and say, I bet there were other inmates in that jail who also had this experience. How could they not? Because I'm going to, I got to be careful doing things like this, but from what we know of Paul and Silas, do you think they had been sharing Christ with those guys all along anyway? This wasn't the first time. I mean, the jailer come right in, he had to have heard some things before all this. And respond the way he did. So we see that there was this approval by certainly the jailer, and I'm going to speculate other inmates as well. So this next part of the story, of this historical event that we're reading through, I kind of read through this and said, okay, I'm looking for the kingdom perspective. I really couldn't find it. Maybe y'all can invite me later if you see what it is. But it says, when daylight, the magistrates sent their officers to the jail with the order, release those men. And the jailer told Paul, hey, the magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. You can leave, go in peace. These are things I love about Paul. But Paul said to the officers, oh, wait a minute. They beat us publicly. They accused us publicly. They humiliated us publicly. Oh, and by the way, we're Roman citizens. We'll get to that in here in just a moment. So Paul was saying, nah, I'm just not going to sneak out. You tell those guys, they come and take me out. I want them to come publicly apologize to me the way they publicly humiliated me. Like I said, I'm not really sure what the kingdom perspective of all that is, but I sure like it. I can relate to that a little bit. I kind of like that thing, but I just couldn't tie it into the title of the lesson. But anyway, so the magistrate or the officer reports to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed, is what my translation says. Why were they alarmed? Because you can't treat Roman citizens the way they were treated. You can't beat them. You can't just throw them in jail without a trial. You can't do all that stuff to a Roman citizen. Whoops. Y'all should have investigated a little bit closer before you did what you did. So now they're really in trouble. So they came, they appeased them and escorted them from prison, requested them, you're out, you just leave town. Just leave. And after Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house, where they met with the brothers and sisters and encouraged them, and then they left. The last king in perspective, encouraging others. It's just the encouraging of others. Before we leave, we need to encourage these people. We planted this church here. We need to encourage them before we go. Plus, you know they were praying for them the whole time. They heard what happened to them. So they had to go by and check in with them and share the story with them. Oh, by the way, if you haven't heard, listen to this great story. And by the way, there's more perspectives for your gathering at the jail. There's a jailer and his family, and I'm going to say there's some other inmates there who want to join your church. By the way, encouraging of others. Very simple thing to do. So again, I don't know. I don't know who you relate to in this event. I don't know if it's Paul and Silas, and you've had those decisions to make. Do we do this? Do we do this? What do we do? Is it God's will? I'm going to put my feelings aside. I'll do what God wants me to do. I don't know if you're Lydia. I don't know if you're a worshiper of God and came to receive a message, and I pray that some kind of message was received today. I don't know if you're an inmate who's bound up just like Paul and Silas was. Something's going on. I don't know if you're Paul and Silas. Is there some kind of chaos going on in your life? I don't know if all hell broke loose around you. All I know is all heaven's got your back. I don't know if you're the jailer. I don't know if you're here this morning and you have no relationship with Jesus Christ. You may be religious, by the way. This is my testimony. You may be religious, but you don't have a relationship. If that's you this morning, what must I do to be saved? We pray that you take that step. If you need to talk to someone, come find me. I'll talk to you about it. I can point you out to a lot of different people who share that with you. I don't know who you are this morning. But I pray that the Spirit will let you know. It may be a message of affirmation that He has for you this morning. Maybe a message of conviction. It requires some repentance. I don't know. But this altar is going to be open. We're going to give you the opportunity to come and pray about that, to find out exactly what it is. Or if you make some kind of decision, you need to share that with it. You might say, well, I just want to do it in my seat. No. Jesus said, if you proclaim me publicly, I will confess you before my Father. There's something to that, y'all. Plus, if you made that decision to come to Christ and be a Christian and to be obedient in that, Scripture tells us that the angels are celebrating, and frankly, we want to celebrate too. They shouldn't have all the fun. So we want to celebrate that with you. Let's pray. Father, we just praise you that you don't just leave us unguided down here, that you do give us a kingdom perspective, because you show us how to live this kingdom life. What we have to do to bring your will to this place. Father, I just pray for myself. I pray for all those who are here. As the Spirit talks with them, that they will respond. Before we sing, I just want to give you that opportunity to pray. Asking the Spirit to show you who you were in this story. Where do you fall in? If there is a decision you need to make, maybe it's just a time to come up and praise God. There's something humbling about coming up and doing that at the altar. So just take a moment and say, God, what do you have for me? What's the message that you've given me this morning? How should I respond this morning? Everybody stand. The altar's open. If you want to come and pray, or you want to come and talk to someone, like say, you can certainly talk to me, or there's others we can get a hold of here that you can talk with. And certainly if you made some decision this morning, that you share that with us. The altar's open. The invitation is there. The Spirit is talking to you.
Let go, my soul, and trust. For the Lord God Almighty reigns.